close in and troubles draw near. Trapped by lies with nowhere to hide, I run to you. Yes, I run to you with arms wide open. You welcome me, and suddenly, like a mystery, my eyes begin to see. In your house I will live forevermore, singing, praising, dancing, Lord my Savior. In your house I am safe and secure, my rock, my tower, Lord, you are my shelter. My rock, my tower, Lord, you are my shelter. And one thing I desire, to be with you, Lord, to be with you. With arms wide open, you welcome me. And suddenly, like a mystery, my eyes begin to see. In your house, I will live forevermore, singing, praising, dancing, Lord my Savior. In your house I am safe and secure, my rock, my tower, Lord, you are my shelter. My rock, my tower, Lord, you are my shelter.
My rock, my tower, Lord.
Lord, you are my shelter.
Greetings. Thank you so much for tuning in to Living Strong today. We appreciate the opportunity to be able to come your way and spend this time with you in the Word of God and also pray with you. We trust that as we come to you week after week, bringing God's Word and just praying with you, that God is impacting your life powerfully. And we'd really love to hear from you. If you could take a moment to drop us an email, write to us, let us know how these programs are touching your life and those along with you who listen to these programs. We'd like to spend a few weeks talking about David. For many of us believers, David is a character, a person in the Bible who is very near and dear to us. We enjoy listening to the stories and incidents of his life and how God worked in him and how God worked on his behalf. And so we'd like to spend some time examining his life over the next few weeks, and specifically to focus in on why David was known as a man after God's own heart. One of the first things most believers will react or respond when they hear about David was called by God himself as a man after God's own heart. For God to say that about a human person is really outstanding. That God would say, here is a man who is after my own heart. He's like the kind of person I really want. He's somebody I'm really looking for. He's a man after my own heart. He knows my heart. He knows what I feel. And for God to say that about David is extremely commendable. And so we want to try to examine, as we look through his life, we like to try to identify what would have been those outstanding characteristics of David's life because of which God said, here's a man after my own heart. Now, of course, we know that this was spoken over David by the prophet Samuel pretty early on in his life, but we know that it was true about David right through the course of his life, that he maintained this very important characteristic or feature about himself, that he was a man after God's own heart. So much so, the Apostle Paul in Acts the 13th chapter, as he's preaching at Antioch in Syria, the Apostle Paul refers back to that and refers to David once again as a man after God's own heart. Another outstanding feature about David's life is that David was a man of one desire. We see this expressed in Psalm 27, when David in that psalm says, in verse 4, he says, one thing I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. So if you and I would, you know, approach David and say, David, you know, give us your statement of purpose. Give us your life statement in one sentence. This would be it. And I'm sure David, without any hesitation, would say, one thing I have desired of the Lord, one thing I've gone seeking after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord, to behold the beauty of the Lord, and to inquire in his holy temple. In other words, David's saying, you know, this is my one desire. This is my one passion. I want to be fixated. I want to be focused on the Lord himself. I want to be able to listen to him and commune with him. As he says, I want to inquire of the Lord in his temple. So David was consumed by this passion. And therefore, we're calling this series that we're doing on David as David, Man of One Desire, just identifying and recognizing that this was his life purpose. This was his passion, to be a man who was just seeking after God, a man of one desire. Other notable characteristics or outstanding highlights of David's life would of course be that he was recognized as a great patriarch of the Jewish people, and he was undoubtedly the greatest king Israel has ever known. There was Saul, there was Solomon, and there were several other kings after David, but none like David himself. And the people of Israel immediately recognized that their greatest king that they ever had in their history was King David himself. And what a outstanding honor, a notable feature of David's life for him to be recognized as a predecessor to Christ himself, that Jesus Christ himself would be known as the son of David. As people called out to him, they recognized him as the son of David. And that's something outstanding that the scriptures bring out to us. So as we look at David's life, just for the purposes of our learning, we've broken his life down into four stages. The early part of his life, we would call it as David's formative years. And then we talk about David's fugitive years, years when he lived as a fugitive, as he had to wander from place to place without any home, away from his own family. And he had an extended time of his life in that manner, living as a wanderer, as a fugitive. And then we talk about the next stage of David's life, which we call as David's famous years, because this was the highlight of his life. In almost 40 years of his life, as 7 years as king of Judah, 33 years as king of Israel, they were the highlight of his life. And then we talk about the last stage of his life, which we refer to as David's final years. This was the concluding part of that 40-year period. We refer to that as David's final years. So we'll break down our examination of David's life into these four stages: his formative years, his fugitive years, his famous years, and his final years. Our objective is, as we look at some of the things that happened in David's life, how he lived, how he reacted, how he responded to various situations, we want to highlight important character traits which you and I could also try to develop in our own lives, which you and I could try to imbibe in our own selves and say, you know, that was a man after God's own heart. And if I want to be a man or a woman, if I want to be a person of one desire, if I want to be a person whom God will look upon and say he or she is a person after my own heart, then I should emulate those character traits that we see in the life of David. And so that's our objective, that we too can be people of one desire, that we too can be people after God's own heart. So David's formative years, we're trying to summarize 1 Samuel chapter 16 through to 20. Of course, in the 13th chapter of 1 Samuel is when we have the prophet Samuel rebuking King Saul and expressing God's displeasure for his disobedience, for his rebellion. And at that time, the prophet Samuel discloses the fact that God has searched throughout Israel. And Samuel said, God has sought for himself. That means God searched. He did a survey, and God sought for himself a man after his own heart. And Samuel, of course, was referring to David. And later on in the 16th chapter, we see Samuel coming to the house of Jesse. Jesse was the father of David. Now, Jesse had 8 sons. David was the youngest, the 8th. Samuel comes to Jesse's house, sent by God, directed by God, and Samuel is on an assignment. He has been sent by God to anoint the next person who was going to be king over Israel, because God had rejected Saul from being king. Now, nobody knows Samuel's assignment. Samuel comes to the house of Jesse and he says, you know, can you just bring all your sons before me? Now, Jesse at that time, he just brings the 7 eldest sons, the first 7 of his sons. He completely neglects David. And David is far away taking care of his sheep. Now, Jesse didn't even think it was of any importance to invite David to be present there when the prophet Samuel came visiting home. So Samuel, under the direction of the Lord, goes through each one of the 7, and God is speaking to Samuel saying, this is not the one, this is not the one, this is not the one. So Samuel's a little confused. He asks Jesse, you know, do you have any other child left? And so they get David to come And when Samuel sees David, the Lord says, this is the one, anoint him. And Samuel anoints David. Now, we just have to try and imagine what was happening. Perhaps, in all likelihood, Jesse and the seven eldest sons did not or could not grasp the significance of what was happening, that their youngest brother, the youngest person in the house, had just been anointed as the next king of Israel. Perhaps they didn't understand that. And so, you know, there was no reaction. They paid no attention to David. David, after being anointed by Samuel, was back taking care of the sheep. There was no promotion in the household order, nothing. There was no change in his life. He was just back taking care of the sheep. And here's an important lesson for us. You know, even if God has disclosed the great plans, the great dreams he has for you, that doesn't mean we become self-important. We just need to stay with God's plan, walk with him a step at a time, and be faithful in what God has called us to do at that season. You don't see any change in David's demeanor. He doesn't go around now flaunting, I have been anointed by Samuel. I have been anointed by Samuel. I'm the next king of Israel. None of that. He's back taking care of the sheep. And that's a very important lesson for us to learn. Now, during this time, King Saul, you know, is having his problems because he's being disobedient to God. The Holy Spirit has left him. He's being troubled now by evil spirits. And he asks, can somebody come and play music for me and help, you know, calm my nerves and so on. And it's very interesting to see that at that time, one of Saul's servants says, hey, I've heard about a young man. He's a son of Jesse. And this young man, he's very skillful in playing. He's also a very brave person. He's a man of valor. And he's also very prudent in his speech. Imagine for a young man to have such a reputation. And you read about this in 1 Samuel chapter 16, verses 17 and 18. That one of Saul's servants will say, you know, I've heard of somebody, a young boy. He's very skillful in playing the harp. He's a young fellow who is very bold and courageous. It's very likely that that must have been the time that David killed the lion and the bear. And that story of him killing the lion and the bear must have spread throughout that region. So people recognize, man, this young fellow is so bold. He's so courageous. So he's called as a man of valor, a man of war. He's a bold guy. He's courageous. And also he's prudent in speech. Amazing for a young person to have that kind of reputation. So it tells us something about how David conducted himself, how David was in one sense being groomed by God out there while taking care of his father's sheep, for him to have such a reputation. So David has the honor of being called into play before Saul. So this is a step forward, and God is orchestrating things in David's life. Whether David understands this or not, he's given this opportunity to be before the king. You see, God's hand upon our life will open those doors for us at the right time. All we have to do is to stay faithful, and God will begin to orchestrate things for us. The next thing we see in David's life, of course, is how David goes out and faces Goliath. Many of us are familiar with that story in 1 Samuel, the 17th chapter. What I want to point out is this, that when David took up the challenge to go face Goliath, here was his confidence. He said, the God who helped me kill the lion and the bear, he will help me conquer Goliath. I'm paraphrasing, of course. And David had this confidence. He said, you know, I killed the lion, I killed the bear with God's help, and this Goliath is no different to me. The same God who helped me kill the lion and the bear will help me kill Goliath. And I'm going out against Goliath because he is an uncircumcised Philistine, whereas I'm a man who has a covenant with God. So David knew and David understood what it meant to be a person in covenant with God. And he had tested out, so to speak, his faith in God when he killed the lion and the bear while tending his father's sheep. You see, the little victories we win when we are in those times being alone with God, in times of obscurity, when we don't have any recognition and fame, those victories are the victories that are going to help us fight and win the bigger battles, the challenges that are out there in public. The reason David could go and face Goliath was because he had proven God in private when he was able to face the lion and the bear or kill them. And now he could go out there to face Goliath in public view. So you and I must learn to win those little battles, gain those little victories in private, because those are the battles, those are the victories that are going to enable us to fight those major battles of life. Once David killed Goliath, he became a national hero. People started singing, the song of David. They began to say, Saul has killed thousands, but David has killed 10,000s. People were celebrating. So David became an overnight celebrity. But what do we see in David's life? Once again, in 1 Samuel, the 18th chapter, it's repeated three times in that chapter, in verse 5, in verse 14, and again in verse 30. That chapter repeats saying, David behaved himself wisely. Although he had become a national hero, people were celebrating him. Saul had promoted him to be in the army, and there was so much recognition. It says, David behaved himself wisely. He did not let this get into his head. He just remained the normal fellow that he was. He just went and walked around the people, just conducted himself in a very simple way. Now, that made Saul afraid. Unfortunately for David, King Saul became jealous of David. He wanted to kill David, and he was after David's life. So that's how the formative years of David ends. God blessed him. God raised him up to a place of stature and recognition among his people. And yet there was trouble right there at that moment with King Saul becoming jealous, King Saul wanting to kill David. And so David was in a very precarious situation. The key thing that we must notice here in 1 Samuel 18 is David behaved himself wisely so that his name became highly esteemed. What can we take away from this first few chapters of David's life, the formative years? We see him being a man who was faithful, even in times of obscurity. Or we see him a man who was passionate about God, so that God would say, he's a man after my own heart during that phase of his life. We see him as a man who was very courageous because he had a personal walk with God. He had a personal history with God. He could step out and face Goliath. We see him as a man who behaved himself wisely, even in the face of great recognition and honor and the face of adversity. He walked with wisdom. Hi there. We're so delighted to introduce to you our free church app. This app is loaded with features and resources that will greatly enrich your life. So head out to the app or Google Play Stores, search for All People's Church Bangalore and download the app right now. It's going to greatly enrich your journey with God. We trust that this program here today, where we just explored the formative years of David's life, brought insights to you that would encourage you to begin to seek God and pursue God in your life in a similar manner that David did. It's for you and me to become people after God's own heart, to be like David, people of one desire, keeping the Lord as the focus of our life, being people who are passionate about God. And maybe take these good character traits of David and begin to build them into our own life. Before we close, I want to take a moment to pray with you and just pray that God will stir up a passion in our hearts to be a people of one desire, like David. Let's pray together. Father, we just ask you that even as we reflect on David's life, that our hearts will be gripped with a similar passion. That we too, O God, will desire to be people after your own heart. That we too, O God, will be people of one desire, having you as our burning desire. And out of that, Father, may we learn to walk with you. May we learn to journey with you through the various stages of life, even as David did. We pray your hand on each one watching. Do a powerful work in our lives, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much for being with us on the program today. And until next time, remember, live life the Jesus' way.
We invite you to visit our church website, apcwo.org, where we have several free resources like MP3 sermons, sermon notes, and publications that you can download and use. You can also call or email us to request a free copy of our publications. And please feel free to share your feedback and do share your prayer requests when you contact us.
There's something about the Psalms I really love. You know, I love the honesty of it, the rawness. You know, it's something childlike. You say he's brutally honest. They are prayers. They are prophetic prayers. It's not just poetry, but it's poetry on fire. You know, so when you put a melody to something like, "The Lord is my rock, my strength, my shield, my strong tower," you know that heaven is agreeing with you. The Psalms were intended for corporate use, and when you sing straight from the Word, you're not only singing to Jesus, but you are singing Jesus because He is the Word and He is perfect theology. Oh God.